Well, friends, I live as though there is a compass, like there are points on a compass in nature, like there's a north and a south and an east and a west. It's not rare for me to navigate with the knowledge of that. So I live as though there is, but there aren't. And it's no game, me living as though there are. And it's true that in nature there is not. There are no points on a compass. I live as though math were a natural thing. It's not. We think that it maps on nature. We may someday discover that it does not, or it's unspeakably crude in its accuracy. But I live as though math is correct. That's clearly the same thing to do. Exactly in that way, and let me emphasize, neither of those am I playing games. Neither of those am I being in some sense silly or cowardly or manipulative. I am taking the best constructs, even though they be constructs of our imagination, for navigating life, navigating physical reality, and I have the ability to live as though they are concrete and true in nature, even though they're not. And this is the same thing to do. Well, Jesus decided, I believe, that living as though there is a Father of us all, was a similarly, if not more, sane thing to do. And to my shock, for the last at least dozen years, I've concluded that he is absolutely right. That the indispensable tool for living out of our heart, for living out of our humanity, is to imagine completely as though it were real, to live it completely as though it were real, that we all have one all-loving, all-knowing Father, and that then, obviously, we are to live as one, exactly one, not many, families, period. No double standards. I suspect, and I say this as a testable hypothesis, psychologically, physiologically, that this is far and away the optimal way of living out of conscience, living out of heart, that nothing else approaches it in its hopefulness or effectiveness for doing so. So with all that, I absolutely do not believe there is a sentient being, an all-knowing, all-loving Father. That what we experience in that is the large part of our brain, the 80% that Einstein said we don't use, and what I think he meant was we can't control, and we choose not to listen to, but that we can. He did. It's so divine, it's so wise, it's so courageous, it's so compassionate, it's so godly, it's so seemingly infinite that it's almost impossible to tap into it and not experience it as God, and it is so serendipitous, so apparently wise, so incredibly wise, that it's hard not to believe there isn't an externally sentient God. And if there is, I could easily not know about it. I say all that because I've just gone through a calculation of when I'll begin, I'm quite sure, my next hunger strike. This is 56 days from the beginning of my first hunger strike, and I consider the hunger strike over today. I experienced that my body, although extremely rocky, is starting to recover today, that it's in been in depletion and crisis since the beginning of the hunger strike, but as of today is beginning to recover. Now, I've just gone through a quick and crude recalculation of when I would start the next one, so that I am there for those of you that lose enough insanity to also enter a hunger strike. I want to support you as best I can. What I do is insignificant. It's you youth that have the real hope, but I need to be there for any of you that lose enough insanity to take this only course of action that gives us any hope of defeating 7 of the 10 largest corporations in time to save humanity, which means for this upcoming election, which means waves of hunger strikes starting this fall in September. Yes, it's insane. What's infinitely more insane is not doing it. So I can't control what you do, but I can control whether I'm there for you. And it's been clear for me for, I believe, several weeks more that that I would be restarting in August or September. And today it came fairly clear to me that mid-August is when I will restart, in the hope of being the pump primed for those of you who can lose enough insanity to also engage in this ultimately powerful Western way of waging unconditional, unviolent war against the death of civilization. And the just astonishingly divine part I went through, looking at an online calendar, calculating just simply by week. 1 week is 7 days, 2 weeks is 14 days, when I would start, when I would begin the next one, and arrived at the middle of August, which made sense to me, that for the few of you that can lose enough insanity to want to join would enable me to have been on hunger strike several weeks before you get to your campuses, maybe beating enough of a path, maybe providing enough inspiration, maybe providing enough confidence, enough inspiration for you to join in this way of fighting. Not me, in this way of fighting, in this struggle. No leaders in this. There were no leaders in the Egyptian Revolution. There was no organization in the Egyptian Revolution. There were people's committed hearts and bodies in this, in the Egyptian Revolution. That's what we need here. They collaborated. They collaborated before they started the revolution. We're probably dead if that doesn't happen here, if someone doesn't start a face page around this, if someone doesn't start a website around this, if people don't start stumbling their best, just like our brothers and sisters in Egypt. They didn't know how the hell they were going to win. They thought they weren't going to win. They knew they weren't going to stay on the sidelines. If we beat the 7 of the 10 largest corporations in the world, the oil companies, it will be exactly the same. We won't know how. There won't be any leaders. There will be first 1, 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, 10 million, a billion committed hearts. That's how it'll happen if it happens. I'm only going to try and do my part to help. So I went through this calculation. And the answer that I came up with was 56 days. And then the next thing I realized, well, it's 56 days since my first one. I think that's pretty cool. So today is T-minus 56. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. All our brothers and sisters in Egypt knew was they weren't going to sit on the sidelines anymore. It's not all they knew. They knew they didn't know how to get rid of Mubarak. They knew they almost certainly couldn't do it. what they knew is they were unwilling to sit on the sidelines anymore. And so it is with every revolution. So it is with every change that has advanced the well-being of humanity. Apartheid, ending slavery, ending child labor, women getting the right to vote, Lewis and Clark crossing the United States, curing polio. If people knew how to bring about change, it wouldn't be change. Change happens when people simply realize they're unwilling not to try. And that's sanity. And that's living. And they are the people who have lived. And there's a part of you that knows they are the people to be envied, not our stupid movie heroes and our stupid sports heroes. My God, their lives are so empty, they self-destruct. When are we going to wake up and follow the real heroes? I'll be there for you, I'm quite sure. I'll be there for you. This is T-minus 56. I'll be there for you if you don't gain enough sanity to undertake your own campaign like this, with or without my help. But Mother Earth won't be there for you. I'll be dead before the worst of it. You young ones will be living through the worst of it, unless we stand up and stop this now. You have the right. I have the right. Unviolently, to block this with our very lives. No one else's lives. No one else's property. Our lives. It's your life. It's not your parents' life. It's not your spouse's life. It's not your children's life. It's your life to serve them with. You have the right. In fact, you don't have the right not to use your life for them. That's why we're here, and that's where the joy is. That's why I'm doing this. That's why I hope you join in this kind of effort. Not me, but in the campaign that far and away shows the most promise for hitting the human heart.